Hello? Yeah. That's better. How's everyone doing? Got a live crowd out there. You guys getting crazy on us, all right? Let's keep it down. All right. So this is the CNC Ski and Snowboard Core Router, slash mold. I'm Jordan Jewett.
I'm Jacob Flint.
So our project was, our client gave us a design who wants a CNC machine that can wrap ski and snowboard cores, which is a 2D design. So the design we were given was to make the CNC machine. We want to be able to make it so it's safe to operate. Some of the main points that he was giving us to touch on, we want to be able to route 2D and 3D axes. For the cores, there's actually, if you look at the edge, there's a contour that goes up and over. So we need to be able to do the actual 3D too. You want to be able to make molds with it, and you want to make it so everyone can run it, easy to use, easy to learn, and obviously has to be operated in a safe manner.
So this is our system overview here. What we use as a UI, user interface, was Mach 3. What we wanted to do was basically have this, the computer be able to communicate with our robotics box, which is, you can see to the right there. The robotics box was, So Mach 3 is how the computer actually communicates with the robotics box. What the robotics box allows us to do is be able to integrate sensors to help us hone and limit our system, to help protect it, and start the process. Next we have another use of the box is actually to engage and disengage the router. Mach 3 allows us to engage that through the user interface. And then the box sends signals to the motors to be able to tell it where to go and how fast or in what direction. The work surface. So we decided to use T-slotted extruded T6061 aluminum because for our application we needed a rugged and durable design, and also it allows for ease of construction, and the parts are very easily sourceable. Tolerances on this material are pretty good. Flatness is 4 thou per inch of width. So that's pretty good. Straightness is 12.5 thou per foot of thick or of length, not to exceed 120 thou over 20 feet of length. What you can see right there is the actual work surface that that we designed and built. It integrates the existing rail system, but what we used was that's actually laid over the steel frame that we got, that we inherited, and it's a 100 inch by 35 inch standalone design, so that means that it doesn't need that steel frame to actually be on, but it's a good base for it. It can stand on the table if you want. What we have here are the mounts and motor mounts and bracing. We actually got a couple of mounts that you can see there. Those are our X mounts. They actually didn't really need much alteration at all because they were actually purchased in the way that they are, and they work perfectly with the rail system or the rail and rack pinion system. But for the Y and Z axes, which you can see. Right there, that's your Z and that's your Y. The mounts needed heavy modification, so we essentially just started from scratch and So that's where, how we ended up with mostly 80-20. And you can see over here on the Y axis, there's a large brace running from one end of the Y axis to the other, and that's actually to prevent oscillation because we were, there was a lot of oscillation in the system when we were run from one end to the other of the Y.
So I was responsible for the steering. This is the Z and Y axis of the router. Also, this is where the X axis sits. So, what is that? So the overall carriage design is 29 inches tall. We inherited one, as Jordan was speaking of, that was twice as tall. It was 5 feet, and we only need to route it down to 2 millimeters. So it was overdone. The T-slotted aluminum, as Jordan said, allows for better square and rigidity. And there's also a lot of brackets and hardware that's easily purchased. And it was just convenient. Right now, the Z-axis right here has a total of 7 inches of travel. So it's a lot tighter than previously. This is an exploded view. Exploded view of the design. Here again, you can see the Z axis and the Y axis. This is some of the hardware that we use to fasten this together. This right here is to represent our router head. And then you see just some collars and the clamps to use. This is an actual picture of the Z axis. Again, you can see the hardware. Makes it really easy to pull apart, assemble, disassemble, maintain if something goes wrong. And it's very compact. Something that we noticed with the fire project was it was very large. The 8020, the T-slotted aluminum, is a very compact design. And as you can see, it's quite clean looking. This is a center of mass calculation done through SolidWorks. You're actually able to put in material properties. So if you have 6061 aluminum, like we have here, you can put that in. The cross members are actually a hardened steel. I'm not sure of what kind exactly. These dots here represent actually the center of mass. So you can see it's quite centered, which is a good thing. We wanted this to be, you know, we didn't want it to be off-center for our design. And lastly, the router controller. It runs a standard wall plug-in router. We wanted to be able to switch this on and off with the user interface. So I designed a solid-state relay switching outlet. It takes the control box output of 5 volts. It runs at approximately 10 milliamps. And when 10 milliamps is put across here, it closes the switch, which actually powers this outlet, which goes to the router.
So what we have here is our control system. So on our control system, the probiotics box was really, really key in this, and it was a great buy. 24-volt power supply is already integrated. It has four motor drivers. We have two of them slaved together to create an X-axis. That gives us 3 axes of travel, and that's what we were looking for in this device. The control board, which you can see there, lets us communicate, lets us add in external inputs and outputs, so we can add in switches, sensors, be able to communicate with our router head, and also be able to communicate with our user interface, and as well as the motors. So it was a really, really good package. So PC usage and requirements, they're not too stringent. You can use a Windows or Linux-based box, but there is what we ended up using was a Windows 7-based system because Windows 7, this was actually optimized for Windows 7. It was based off from Windows XP, but the system's been around since the early 80s, but it's been developed, and this was actually our optimal system. If we wanted to end up using Windows 7 or Windows 8, we actually wouldn't be able to. We'd have to change our system around because the parallel port has been actually phased out because it's such an antiquated system. So, let's see. So, basically, the reason why you don't want to use a laptop is because of power saver mode, but actually we ended up running into the same issue with our standard desktop, and that actually causes a lot of issues when it powers down. Sometimes the system can just be a little bit buggy, so turning off power saver options really eliminates a lot of headaches, and laptops tend to try to run power saver mode often.
A big part of running any CNC machine is accuracy. So what homing allows you to do is bring the machine to the same spot every single time, and it's what the machine actually is known as an absolute 0, 0, 0, 0, which would be your X, Y, and your Z. So the homing sequence, it brings it all to the designated area. If you look at the machine now, I think I have a picture here too, but if you look at the machine now, it's pretty close to home. Home would be all the way left, all the way towards you, and then Z all the way up. This is crucial because if you're working on a machine or you're working on a part, you can bring it to that position and it's out of the way. Nothing's going to hit you, nothing like that. Like I said here, puts it in a safe zone. So I came into a little problem to do this because you want to run a limit on every axis, but you also need a home switch. In order to fix this, I made it so my home switch could roll. So in this case, this home switch is hit, but the limit switch is not hit yet because it's going past the home. Because if you were to do it the other way, that if you hit that limit switch, then you're always going to hit your limit as you make your home, so you'll never be able to get a true home port. From the 0, 0, 0, you can set work offsets. In fact, on that piece, how we have it set now, we have it set to a different location for our zeros to start. And this is important when it comes to making your parts, because you don't always want to go off that one corner. So another thing, like I just touched on, is the limiting system. The limiting system uses limit switches and keeps the machine head, in this case the router, in a designated area. This is important so there's no overdrive on any accesses, which can cause it to crash if things you don't want it to. So how this system's done is it's a system with switches. There's a switch on the plus and negative of every axis. In addition, there's an emergency switch. So if any one of these switches are tripped throughout anything, even if it's just in a setup, it'll put the machine in emergency stop mode. Once it's in emergency stop mode, then the operator has to address it to get it out of emergency stop mode. So that's handy. If it's routing something and it gets off the axis where it doesn't need to be, it's going to stop. So I keep running, the whole machine will shut down. So for here, you can see a diagram. I got, like I said, the home position's right here. A Y positive travel and X positive travel. So you're looking at the machine just about as it says right there. You have a X negative and an X positive. Well, like I said, this has the home and the limit, so I have the roller switch assembly. But other than that, you can see what the Y limit switches are. And in this case, there's a Z positive. We didn't incorporate a Z negative. Most machines don't. It's kind of one of those things where you don't run it into the part or you don't run it into the table. That's the operator's job to make sure he's not. I guess you could do like a proximity switch or something like that on it. That was a little bit more than we had time to do. So here is the wire diagram for it. As you can see, the home switches are wired individual, and those are normally closed. They're all normally open, never mind. So they're wired normally open, and as soon as that home switch is hit, then it'll move on to the next part of the procedure. So it'll hit your Z home, then your Y home, then your X home. In addition to that, you can see the limit. The limits are all run off the same port because no matter what, one limit is hit or the E stop is hit, then it needs to go power. What we ran into an issue with is once that switch is hit on any limit, you can't actually get your system out of it because it's always on that limit. So what we did is we put in an override switch on the ground. So you can hold the override switch, back the machine off the limit, and then you're good. You can go back into your regular operation.
So this is more of the behind the scenes programming. The feed rate and distance calibration. So the feed rate is how fast this router is actually moving through a part when it's routing. And the distance calibration is exactly what you think it was. If you want that x-axis to move an inch and it moves 5 inches, then you have a problem. So this is kind of a rundown of how you switch that. This is the user interface. Right here it says distance or steps per unit. You click into there, you pick the axis that you want to change. You feed it a unit, be it in inches or millimeters, depending on the setting. And then you just do the manual work. You take a tape measure out or calipers, depending on how accurate you want to be, and you tell the machine exactly how far it moved. And luckily enough for us, it does all the math. It spits out steps per unit. You accept it, and it runs that distance. Motor tuning. It's kind of hard to see here, but this is your steps per unit. And this is the velocity, so this is your feed rate. For ours, I believe we have it set just under 30 inches per minute. When it's calibrated, it looks kind of slow, but it's perfect for our routing speed. And kind of the heart and soul of the whole project. This is G-code. G-code is for CNC. CNC stands for Computer Numerical Control. So this is the numbers that it's reading. As you can see here, we have a profile of ski. This is through SolidWorks. HSM Works gives us that blue line you see is actually a tool path. So you make a solid model. You feed HSM the solid model. And then you tell it what kind of profile you want to make, be it 2D milling, 3D milling. And it will generate this path for you. HSM Works also comes standard with a post-processing, which for Mach 3, luckily enough, we had that. This is the G-code that it runs. A few things here that I can tell you is, like, I deleted some of this to fit it in, just the XY motion. Like the M5 here is making sure the router's off. M3 is turning the router on. You have your X and Y coordinates. You get to the end of the program, it's going to go back to zero, it's going to home itself and then shut down. This is the back plot of the code. This is showing you exactly what it's going to do from the origin of the part.
So a big part of our project was time. It took quite a lot of work to get that done. As you can see here, we broke it down into major categories. As you can see, we got motor controllers, sensors, carriage, router, power cable. And within that, we have smaller categories. We tried to break it down and guess the hours it was going to take us. For each category, we had a milestones list. So for example, on the motor control, our milestone was make sure the motors are running and going in the direction that the computer's telling them. So when we did all this, we guessed it. We guessed it was going to take us about 60 hours. Actually, it takes about 82. It did take quite a lot of time, but I'd say we did it in a pretty good time. Here is another look at the chart I just showed you, except you can see it, how the time laid out. This is fairly accurate to how it went. There's a couple dates that are a little off, but for the most part, we're done on deadline when we need to. So the budget for it, most, like we were saying, we had some parts from it. We bought and had to make a whole lot more though. Most of it, I'd say, was in that T-slotted aluminum, that and all the mounting brackets. It gets rather expensive. Our total budget was $778. I'd say for the machine it is and the money we had in it, it's well worth that. And we got questions, but I'm gonna actually run a demo over there. Cut out another cord, kind of like what's on the desk. It's going to take a couple minutes, but if you guys want to watch it, you're more than welcome.